Thanks for staying with us. Now, is power a good or bad thing? Abraham Lincoln was quoted to have said, "Nearly all men can stand adversity, but if you want to test a man's character, give him power." Now, the world has changed and has kept all of us with a lot of questions. There has been a lot of power play, especially in the economic, political, and socio-cultural space. Now, to understand the future of world power, one needs to be strategically positioned. Olakunle Soriyan is a polymath, iconoclast, catalytic thought leader, keynote speaker, whose expression spans across the globe as he continues to influence and shape cultures. Now, remember, you can join this conversation. Tweet at us at +TVAfrica or at WayShowAfrica1 with the hashtag Ways, or you send us an SMS or WhatsApp to 081-803-84663. All right, so before our guest joins the conversation, Sanzi, yeah, you made a very interesting comment, and I think I want to start with you. So when we talk about power, like people are discussing power dynamics and all of that, a lot of young people are not interested. And I wonder why. Tell me why.
Well, the thing is, first of all, for the younger generation, our attention span is like so short. So we need, that's why we like a lot of flashy stuff, because when it's flashy, it just grabs the attention, and then we can maybe hang around for like 2 minutes or 3 minutes or thereabout. So when you say power dynamics, I'm like, what is that? No, does it make sense? No, you know what? I'm moving on. So, but let's say if you say, okay, this is how to be powerful, or this is how to be influential, and then we'll sit down and literally listen to you, because everybody wants to be influential, you know? So in the middle of it, you now tell us what we want, what we should hear, but you've already captured our attention. So I think the thing is, because we make it look so strong, like power, and people are like, no, I'm not interested. Mm. So we are the kind of generation that you need to soft pedal to lure us.
Do you agree with that? Because I see you nodding your head, Nasa.
I mean, I'm young, right? So I can relate with Sanzi. But yeah, I hear her in terms of, you know, when I hear power dynamics, I'm like, okay, what's this about? It just sounds very heavy, and it's like, you know, just I don't want to be part of this. And just like, so almost something like someone with a doctorate we want to discuss. And so I guess I understand why we have a coalition.
Absolutely. And I think he's joining
that iconolast. Yes,
so I can't pronounce it.
I can't.
Hi, Olakunle Soriyan, PK. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you for bringing me on.
Okay, so PK, did you hear our little banter on power dynamics? Maybe you should help us to explain it, because I think a lot of young people, they don't understand that there's something happening globally, right? There's a lot of power shifts and change of power and all of that. We are not focused on that. So there's a psychology of power. You know, I think that is, you know, the biggest thing in all of these dynamics that I think that is playing out. So maybe you should start from there, you know. Help us break it down.
I hear you. I hear you. First of all, I disagree with the idea that the young generation are not hearing the sound of power, you know. Yeah. I think the representation of it is what is different, right? You know, I'm sure everybody on that set are not Generation Z. You'll be lucky to be millennials.
We are millennials.
So you probably don't even fit the profile of the restlessness of youth that we are talking about. Your generation is still more into the serious change of life. Maybe you are just being kind by trying to identify with a much younger generation of Gen Z and the extreme millennials. But the truth is, people want power. What do you think all of the crime you see it's about? What do you think all of what you call internet fraud and cybersecurity fraud and all of the fast life young people want to live, big cars and, you know, wear big chains and live in big houses. You know, they want to live in, you know, big luxury neighborhoods. They want to drive the fastest cars in the world. Why do you think they want to do that? It's because their representation of power, right, speaks to those things. So young people understand power more than ever before. What they miss is the curriculum, is the character of that power, right? And to that we must turn. That is why your topic about the psychology is very critical, right? Because I think that every generation, it is wrong to think there's no human being. Power is a natural thirst. There's no human being that doesn't want some form of power in his life. Powerlessness is a state of the mind, though, but most people don't know. So they want to have power by any means necessary, regardless of how noble or debased, you know, that commitment is. I think what we should begin is to define what power is, you know. And power essentially is the ability to do something or to act in a particular way. The ability to do something or to act in a particular way. And if you expand that a bit, then power is the capacity or the ability to direct or influence the thinking. Please listen to that. To direct or to influence the thinking and the behavior of others, or to determine the course of events, to create the course of events. Now, once you miss that definition, you are out of the power block. You are now in the block of the recipients of power, or the audience of power, or those who power get impacted on. So you can either be amongst the stakeholders of power, or you are going to be in the audience of power, which is where the recipients of it are, those who experience it are, or you want to be a stakeholder. Because to be a stakeholder, which is what I think is the problem in the world, is because a lot of people and a lot of communities, intellectual community, racial community, whatever the community is, a lot of them are not taking responsibility for power as far as behavior governance, governing thinking, or determining the course of events is concerned. The moment you remove that part from your power equation, you are powerless. So I think the conversation should be between being powerful and being powerless. And then if you are powerful, what exactly does that mean for society? You know, how does that work? Will we call Adolf Hitler powerful? Do we think that Bin Laden is powerful? Or was Mother Teresa powerful? Or Martin Luther King Jr.? Or Mahatma Gandhi? You know, so what exactly is power? Does it bring good things? Can it bring bad things to people? Or is it the abuse of it that brings bad things
to people,
such that the real thing produces only good things? Just like wisdom. Wisdom cannot rob a bank, but intelligence can rob a bank. So both of them, are they both forms of power? Because somebody who has a gun in his hand can be very intelligent and choose to rob a bank. But somebody who is wise can never do anything negative. Wisdom is a form of power that does not produce negative experiences. But intelligence can do that. So the presence of power, what are the outcomes? Absence of power, what are the outcomes? So it's either people are powerful or they are powerless. And some of the people that we think are powerful are actually powerless. So somebody with a gun who can rob a bank or rob a house can be said to have some form of power, but is a powerless human being. It's a powerless human being because it's not able to multiply value, and so it does not understand power. So with his gun, it's in an abuse of power. The same thing goes for the criminal, the rapist, and whoever you think about. The political ideology that doesn't work for the human condition. All of those things, from Adolf Hitler to Bin Laden, these are, cowards in the corridor of power. Powerless individuals, right? So let me leave it there.
In fact, you said so
That's
much.
A brilliant definition on power.
It is.
It says a lot.
So here's what I want to say. You talk about powerful people and powerless people, and I'm thinking power distance, right? And the whole phenomenon about the group of people who feel that are less powerless, that feel that, you know, the more powerful people have the right to control them, if you like, and so basically that the power they wield over them is unequal. Like, so some people have that authority. And linking that to socio-cultural norms and how, you know, in countries like Nigeria and in the Asian countries where there's a high power distance, it's linked to that sort of culture where some people have that authority because of their position. So in the family, for instance, the father has the final say and so on. And you see this across board. So what are your views on this? And when you talk about why would some people feel they're powerless and some people ascribe that power above them?
Yes, I hear you. So like I said earlier, powerlessness is a state of the mind. It's like helplessness. Helplessness is a state of the mind. Action is always within reach, depending on the clarity you ascribe to yourself or that you have yielded yourself to. When we know better, we do better. But when we know less, we perform to installed capacity. And so when people suffer from the wielding of power, it's not that they are powerless, but they are unaware of their own power. So automatically, it's not the absence of power that creates abuse. It is the, you know, premium we place on power because we don't even understand how much power we have. So the person who thinks is powerless is as assumed that is an, you know, powerlessness is assumed. It's not real. Every human being is created with options.
Okay.
In every situation you find yourself, when you lack the capacity to photograph your options, you define your powerlessness. Yeah. So the moment you can photograph your options, then you are powerful on the table. I say to salespeople, for example, the most powerful person on any negotiation table, whether it is in the moral construct, in the social construct, or in the political construct, or in the socioeconomic construct, the most powerful person on the negotiation table is the one that is ready to walk away without a deal. The one that is ready to walk away without a deal. The one that must have a deal is powerless,
so,
is weak.
PK, but so how many people want to walk away? How many people want to walk away without a deal? I think that's where it lies. Someone has something you have. I'm not willing to walk away.
So that is why I said, when you lack the understanding of the options available to you, you see, there is another weaker option. The idea that your prevailing negotiation table is the only table of negotiation. Because you walk away from a table does not mean there are not other tables. Mm. So for example, if you go for auditioning and the movie owner or the movie producer says that you are not going to get airplay on the movie except he sleeps with you, that is his own expression
of power,
of his understanding of power.
Mm-hmm.
But if you don't know that, no, options are infinite. Mm. Options by design are infinite. Your table is one of the tables. If I go back into myself and I respect the design of the human condition, I will either find another option or create one. That is exactly what this guy is doing in Atlanta. What's his name? The black movie producer?
Tyler Perry.
You know, and he's saying, look, if you don't invite us to your own party,
we will
create our own party, right? So we've got to come to that level of understanding. Let me say this because it's important. When you hear words like victim, when you hear words like poverty, when you hear words like slavery, victim, poor, slave, you see those three words, they mean the same thing. Right? Some people in the majority, of course, there's a majority or popular definition of those words that make them look different. But there is a common condition that binds them together as one. So whether you are poor or you are a slave or you are
a victim,
right? What binds you together is that the three lack the capacity to control their necessary due human experiences. When you don't have a control over your necessary human experiences, like right to happiness, right to pursue the highest dream that you believe in, to receive the attention your individuality deserves, to culture hope as your self-created instrument to pursue your highest ideals, the idea of equality, that you are born within a human world to communicate the greatness of your own existence as a right, not as a tolerated experience. When you understand, when you lack all of that, it means you cannot control, you cannot manipulate your necessary human experiences. That is when you are a slave, because when you look at it, both the slave, the poor, and the victim are all incapable. Bottom line is that they are incapable of controlling their necessary human experiences. In other words, they cannot give life to their preferences. They cannot give life. So a slave cannot go to where he wants to. He cannot eat when he wants to. He cannot work when he wants to. The poor lacks the capacity, the resources to go where he wants to do what he wants to wear what he wants, to eat what he wants, right? The victim is also incapable of defending his own virtue or her own virtue, of protecting his own dignity, or celebrating his own human condition. You see, so both of them are defeated by that, you know, absence of control over their necessary human experiences.
Okay,
and
so
when you look at it from, yeah.
So
yes,
would
yes.
you say the poverty level in Nigeria is a reflection of people's mindsets and the level of power they feel they have? Because it's very high.
Oh, sure. You cannot be prosperous above the clarity you have about the options that exist in you. Let me say this. You see, the critical idea is education. If you see any oppression anywhere, that oppression was created by the oppressed. The oppressor is an invented quantity by the oppressed. The ignorance or the nescience or the apathy of the oppressed is the creation of the oppressor. The oppressor needs the ignorance of the oppressed to continue to find existence and room. And so the oppressed is the one actually that is holding the stage for the oppressor to act.
Yeah.
And there is no way you can hate your oppressor if you are not going to, first of all, discontinue the stage that you uphold for the oppressor to dance.
That's right.
You
okay,
see,
so
that is very critical. And that's how I see it.
All right, PK, you you know, when you're with us, we hardly can put in our questions because
you know what?
There's a connection between money and power, right? And for us on this table, we want to understand, you know, the psychology of that. And if at all, we are saying that all of these people, based on where we are now, from what you have said, it is based on our level of understanding that has kept us at certain levels where we are at, if I understand you correctly. How do we begin to shift this perspective? You know, so how do we begin to change? Because we're talking about the dynamics of power in 2020. There's a huge power that the people wield, but they don't know that yet, right? So if we were to shift perspectives for people to begin to understand the power that they wield, now to start to demand for the greatness that they should enjoy, how do we shift that perspective?
Yeah, you know, like I said, I think it comes down to education. Nonprofits need to understand that placards are not factors of advancement. And I'm going on the street and shouting, and you know, I mean, people are realizing that social media, for example, is a good instrument for democratizing a conversation. It is never enough to enforcing that conversation. So when you define the ultimate expression of your power by a limit that you prefer yourself, you deny the populace, because I see a lot of people online who are lashing on conversations so that they can gain traction for whatever they are doing or to themselves. Their cause, the CAUSE, is not really their critical priority. They are just lashing on an idea, and then we make noise on social media, and we noise. I can tell you tons of noise on social media that has not led to any creative, organized action.
I say it right? all the time, but PK, you know what? I would have to hold on to that conversation because we need to go on the break. We'll be right back. We'll still have Olakunle Soriyan with us.